Hi there, welcome to the QNUTS booth at CES 2025. This is Code the Future. With me today, I have Jochen Rein, Director of Embedded Software and Systems at Vector, and Justin Moon, VP of Core Product Engineering at QNUTS. Justin, Jochen, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks, Matt. Appreciate it.
So, Jochen, I want to start with you. For those that are not familiar, why don't you tell us a little bit about Vector, your role in the industry, what you do, your mission?
Okay, yeah, Vector, it's a company founded in 1988. And we are doing all the software for the automotive industry. So we, on the one side, we provide the tools. We have Canoe, we have Prevision, we have Candelar, so a lot of different tools. We have, which is broadly used in this area of automotive. And we have also the embedded software. So this is my responsibility, the embedded software. Therefore, we provide the complete ecosystem for the embedded software from a very small microcontroller up to the HPCs together with QNX then, that we do using above of the operating system operating our stack. Yeah, but this is, and we meanwhile 4,500 employees, 90% software developers, so we are really a software-driven company. Yes, this is Vector, so we have a good footprint within this market, and we are one of the market leader, I would say, in this area.
It seems like the SDV space at CES grows with every passing year, and it seems like it grows in tandem with the complexity of the software that goes into today's vehicles. It's been said that OEM heads of software have arguably the most difficult job in the industry. Talk about some of the challenges that go along with integrating software, developing software, deploying software across global development teams.
Please, go ahead.
Okay, then I will. Okay, yeah, it's one of the challenges what they have, okay. On the one side, they were used that they have tier ones who provides a complete module, not just software. They provided the module. Now they wanted to do the software by their own. But if you look to a complete vehicle, I think it's one of the most complex ecosystem, one of the most complex software.
I would agree.
Yeah, so from a very small one to the very big one. And first of all, I think, okay, they are more and more used to have agile methods. That's not a topic anymore. But I think a little bit the topic is regarding, let's say, to define the architecture and all the things. And what we also see at the automotive industry, they often still, some call it HDV instead of SDV. So it's a hardware-driven vehicle. That means they're very organized to the hardware system. That was in the past. To do the transition to be really software-driven company, that means this is a hard job for them. And therefore, this is one topic, that you have an organization which fits to the software. And on the other side, to have a clear architecture and not a hardware architecture, a software architecture.
Until then.
And a software architecture has to be able to deploy to different hardware architectures. And we often see they still think in the hardware architecture and not in the software architecture. But I think this is a challenge. That means for the software engineers, for the software departments, it's the first topic, that everyone knows it's a software development team and not a hardware developer. That's the challenge.
I think one of the biggest complexities that kind of gets overlooked, when we talk about software complexity, we're talking about the software that actually runs inside the vehicle. But if you think about all of the things outside of that during the entire developer journey, there's a ton of complexity in that as well. So if you think about just a common CI/CD pipeline, just DevOps generally, extremely complex, and if not done properly, can cause a lot of grief in your development teams. With working directly with Vector, I mean, there's a lot of really bright futures in terms of CX, pipeline management. We're talking a lot about different ways for platform configuration and stuff like that. It's really important to have technology partners in these that understand that entire journey from a developer perspective. It isn't just about the embedded software. It's really choosing technology partners for any program that really understands what your developers need as opposed to just what's going in your car. And I think that complexity is overlooked. It's not overlooked by our teams because it's how that our teams live on a daily basis, but the software teams in the OEMs, there's a lot of focus that kind of sits in the embedded software, the vehicle software itself. We just can't lose sight of that prior order complexity as well.
That's a great point. I mean, would you say we're kind of at a bit of an inflection point in terms of the OEMs recognizing that they can't or shouldn't do all the software in-house and that they ought to look to third-party experts like Vector and QNUTS in terms of some of that non-differentiation?
I think more and more. I think they did it to really, because we are providing, let's say, a base layer. We provide the foundation. And I think this is a little bit gone, that each of the OEMs wants to be by themselves. But also the higher layers, to really the applications, it's not just you can just buy the applications, this is what you mentioned, this is not the big part. It's really how to integrate the application, how to maintain the application, and how to test it. Because on the other side, it's also very, very important speed, speed, speed. That means you cannot just say, okay, I develop my application, perhaps I'm fast to develop my application, but to be able to integrate it into the vehicle, it takes me weeks or months. And I think this is also one of the topics that partly underestimated the complete ecosystem, which is really required to develop a software efficiently.
And that's the opportunity. That ecosystem is the opportunity. It's not necessarily about recognition from an OEM perspective. It's a proof point in the industry today that industry collaboration is necessary in order to enable that next step. And then there was an announcement made between our companies, and that's the reason for the partnership that we have together, is to really solve, as you said, that undifferentiated lift, really build a strong foundation, as Jochen has said, for the OEMs to innovate. And it's not, again, just about the tech. We also have to consider things around safety. I mean, we're building safe systems at the end of the day. Security of those, 21434 and all of the WP29 and all of the government regulation things, we have to consider those things as well. And it's what we do as technology companies, as true software companies. These are the things we think about every day. What we need to do is make it easier for the OEMs to not just ingest the software, but ingest everything so that they can truly focus on their value add, which is the features, the applications, as Jochen had said.
And if you look to the complete system, it's so complex. So we are doing, let's say, HPC, but it's much more like a HPC. So it's really from the smallest sensor up to the zonals, to the HPC, to the cloud.
Yep.
So it's really complete, a huge ecosystem.
That's a great point, because you know I'm talking about an HPC. Jochen's point is it's a vehicle.
Yeah.
It's not an HPC.
This is it's a huge and a really huge and complex mechatronic system. And you see often the car manufacturers, they get it done the HPC, but they didn't care about the complete system sometimes. Meanwhile, so then on one side the HPC and on the other side they have a vehicle. How to bring it together, that's really the topic.
You're in a lot of conversations with customers, a lot of customer meetings and whatnot. Is that aligning with what you're hearing from them?
Yes, absolutely.
They've recognized that it's time to...
We are in a lot of joint meetings. And it is what we're being told. I mean, the industry is ready for a collaboration platform like we've started.
Are there any dangers to, you know, the OEMs handing the keys to you guys?
They're not really handing the keys. We're building foundational software that they need to build on top of, but we're also building it in an extremely transparent way. So the OEMs see everything. That we're building this transparently, source code will be available for a lot of the components. They're not necessarily handing the keys. Maybe it's a key share.
Yeah, exactly. And so it's also for us, let's say, we provide our software completely as source code.
Today, already.
Already. This is what we are used to do, that we provide each of the code, which is in a vehicle, it's completely provided as a source code. And our customers, they even have the possibility to do own changes. And we can take over the maintenance and maintain it, and all the things that we can do. And so we are wide open, both of us. So we want not to be a black box deliverer. We want to be really in white box together with our customer, and we want to have the partnership with our customer.
So how do you see SDV development, I guess, transforming over the next 5 years? I mean, obviously, adoption of this sort of model is what we're hoping for. Anything else that you would call out in terms of, you know, significant trends that you think, the industry is on the cusp of when it comes to SDV development?
I think the adoption of cloud native is something that's going to be really key moving forward.
Copy.
Not necessarily just cloud services, but actually cloud native development and cloud first development. Yeah. The idea of being able to scale a global developer team, leveraging the same exact environment, both from a build and tooling perspective, but also that runtime environment as well, all completely, it's virtualized, but it's not virtualized, it's a cloud. You know, running everything on a scalable platform, be it whatever hyperscaler.
And do you think this might be a bit at a left field, but do you think that shift was accelerated by the pandemic with people being in all different sorts of locations, less tied to hardware, There was a shortage of chips.
The chip shortage, I think, was probably bigger than the pandemic.
Yeah, but it happened at the same time.
The same time. Yeah. That's what, yes, definitely. Teams had to figure out what remote collaboration looked like and had to adopt things that maybe they were less comfortable with in kind of the traditional embedded.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, cloud collaboration in other markets, in mobile and all of the, it's the de facto standard. That's what everyone does. But when we start thinking about kind of our more regulated industries, like in the automotive space, for instance, cloud was something, this is a really bad word, but nebulous. But I mean, the hyperscalers did come in and they educated well.
Yeah.
They went to every major OEM and they really showed the power of what it meant. And not just the runtime, but they're also providing a lot of guidance on what good CX pipelines look like. What do good developer workbenches look like? What does that workflow, how do the developers actually interact with one another? And that's a big thing maybe as part of, you know, what Vector's doing moving forward from a software factory perspective.
And the other topic is also, let's say, the interfaces, the APIs, the service definition. I think this will be also, and it's coming along together with the cloud native.
Absolutely.
How to keep it and how to provide the possibility to update the apps and not, okay, I have to update this app, but there's an interface to something else. And this is really the cloud native topic. So containerization, what I have to put in my container, and then microservices, how to deal with the interfaces outside. That is, I think, also a topic what we have to consider here also in the next 5 years.
Yeah, I think, yeah, the whole idea of containerization kind of dovetails into the from cloud native into what these containers are today.
And the other topic is to integrate complete other ecosystems. Let's say if you look, let's say, to Android or something else,
yep.
then it's not, they do not provide just an, like we do, a software, an open box. They provide a complete ecosystem together. And that means you have to be able to connect this other ecosystem, because you have not one huge ecosystem. It's an ecosystem of an ecosystem, what we have to take care of for. And I think this will be another topic.
There's been a ton of headlines in terms of, you know, some of the challenges that OEMs have faced in terms of what the end users experience at the end of that journey, right? Obviously, this is something that, you know, is fundamental to the mission of our two companies in terms of making it easier for the OEMs to deliver new features and capabilities or whatnot. But do you think, to a certain extent, part of the onus ought to be on user interface design and end user education? Like, we can't just be pushing over the air updates and expect that, you know, drivers and passengers are just going to be able to get it. I think, what's your sense in that regard?
I mean, UX is extremely important, and so much so that government regulators actually comment on it. NHTSA has UX guidelines that anybody who's creating something that moves in a vehicle moves. I mean, graphics.
Yeah.
Anything that's animated, there are strict guidelines and rules that have to be followed. But I think the usability thing is something that really isn't discussed. It's more about non-distraction. Not necessarily about usability. I think UX is important, absolutely.
Yeah.
And therefore you have to have a clear split between UX and the vehicle. So it has to be, we are back to the ecosystems. You have one thing, that's your UX. And you have to provide a UX for your customer independent of the complexity of the complete vehicle. And therefore this is one of the topics they have to take care of, that they provide an easy interface for a complex topic.
Yeah. I know this is a bit of a contrarian question, but how far gone do you guys think the evolution towards SDV is? I mean, 500 million lines of code in the average vehicle today is like, it's incredible. These vehicles aren't cheap, right? And we know, you know, cost of living, compounding that. Do you think there's any sort of market for dumber, not smart vehicles out there? Like, I remember years ago, there was an announcement, I forget what OEM it was. I'm not even sure if the vehicle saw the light of day, but it was in India, and it was a very, you know, simple vehicle. I want to say it didn't have a radio, it didn't have windshield wipers, it didn't have AC, but it was affordable. And when, you know, you're trying to appeal to masses, you know, that sticker price is important. So are you familiar with any OEMs out there that are working towards that kind of slice of the market, or do you think, you know what, the entire industry is going to SDV?
First of all, I think the vehicle you mentioned, it was not a success story. It was not a success story.
Yeah.
Because the people want to have such comfort and all these things. That means, I don't think it's the right way to say, okay, let's do not use such stuff and just keep it very simple, this will be very huge. I think it's how to get it possible to have such a system with all the features, perhaps a little bit less, but still the features available for all classes of
FMCG. And it comes back to the ecosystem of ecosystems. It's how do we actually, as an industry, pull those together and make it easier, streamline for the OEMs to develop these things.
And so you are right, we will have different classes and we will have different feature sets, but I think it will not be that we will have a car like we had 20 years ago or something. I think it will not be. You will always have your screen and all things.
So everyone will need to save their money, is what you're saying.
Yeah. I think in the end, I'm not sure would save money if you do a car line which directly uses such a simple way, because it's another way. That means it's again a complexity. So it's
you're still having to solve the similar challenges just in a different way.
Yeah.
No, that's a great point. It's a great point. Okay. If you could give your younger self one piece of advice, starting out in the industry, what would it be and why? Knowing what you know now, going back 20, 30 years, what would be the one piece of advice? You go first.
Give you time for me.
It's a longer time, so it's more behind me. I think it's always okay. I think if you now start. For me, it was easier at this time when I started because it was not so complex.
Different world.
And so it was a different world. So for I grow with my time, it gets more and more complex. But don't be hesitant about the complexity. And it takes time, but then you will understand.
Yeah.
And if you do not understand, then you are in trouble, let's say. You have to understand what you are doing and be eager.
Yeah.
And to learn. And try to do single things as simple as possible. Make it as simple as possible. And not think, well, yeah, it's great complex. No, you have always to go down to a level you are able to handle, to understand, and to manage. That's what I would say, and so don't be hesitated about the complexity. That would be my message.
I love it. Wise words, for sure. Justin,
base principles outweigh elegance, always.
Meaning,
it's keep it simple.
Keep it simple. Stupid. Yeah.
That's the age old after.
Yes, exactly. You have not to be proud about the complexity. You have to be proud about the security, the places.
So if I need to maintain this piece of code for the next 30 years, should it be 500 million lines of code or should it be?
Great point. Okay. Good stuff. Well, thank you both so much for taking the time to keep with us. We'll see where this vehicle software platform ends up over the next.
It's going to be great, man.
Looking forward to hearing more, though. Thank you both.
Okay, thanks, man.
Take care.